And Johnny said, "Well," he said, "I'll take it outside and throw it up in the sky." I said, "No." I said, "We don't do that." I said, we give to the Lord through the church. Well, Carson's a little bit different. Carson's wired a little bit differently. And we had the same conversation with the Lord. We had the same conversation with Carson. And Carson said, "Did the Lord create everything?" I said, "Yeah, He created everything." And Carson said, "Well, why does the Lord need it?" Carson's a little bit different. So we had to have a little bit of a longer conversation with Carson. he's got a lot more of that gunt in him than Johnny does. I've had to have the same conversation with my wife. No, I'm kidding. No. but we should give as the Lord's blessed us to do so. By the way, that was for the radio station. I'm up here talking about the weather for 20 minutes and forgot what I'm supposed to be doing up here. That offering was for the radio station. We do own a radio station. You can find it at 90.5 on your FM dial. And we give every morning, every week at this time, and goes to our radio station. And I want to encourage you, in all seriousness, we do need to, because this is a time, this kind of weather, a lot of people are feeling under the weather, a lot of people are sick, a lot of people are feeling bad, and so we do need to pray for one another. Well, you don't know what the person you're sitting next to is going through. Even if you're married to them, you don't necessarily know all that they're going through. So we need to pray for one another. We need to pray for every worker, volunteer, staff member, director, ministry, and missionary connected with the Faith Baptist Church. And we need to pray for our pastor and his family in a special way. On a daily basis, we should pray for our pastor and his family. All right. Brother Ron's got the mic. We didn't do this last week because we started on last week. So, you know, we'd only been started for one day. But some of y'all have mentioned y'all found some nuggets in the Bible reading. So we're going to take a few minutes, not too long now. We're going to take, you know, 10 or 15 minutes, depending on how many hands go up. But does anyone want to share something that they have found in the course of the 60-day Bible reading revival? It doesn't matter if you're ahead. Doesn't matter where you are. Don't say, "Well, I can't share because we're past that book." Doesn't matter where you are. Does anyone want to share anything? All right, Brother Bill. Now, if you have a question, you can ask it. And if I can't answer it, I got Brother Barker and Brother Donnell and Brother Rowan in here. And one of them should be able to handle it.
What amazed me was in Deuteronomy how their clothes and their shoes lasted 40 years.
Now that would have to mean that nobody gained any weight. Wouldn't that have to mean, or either they didn't gain weight or their clothes expanded with them? You know, it's got to be one of the two. Yeah, but what I'm saying is the clothes didn't wear out, that's fine. But in order to keep wearing them, you have to have not gained any weight.
Paul said he wouldn't have been in that crowd.
That's true. They walked everywhere they went. Brother Bill, I got a lot of clothes, Brother Bill, that haven't worn out, but I can't wear them anymore because I'm a little bigger than I used to be. So that's a miracle in and of itself. All right, Brother James Jones.
Over in Exodus 4:23, I was amazed at the fact that God had given Pharaoh pre-warning of that he was going to kill his son if he didn't let the people of Israel go. It says, "And saying to thee, let my son go, that he may serve me. If thou refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay thy son, even thy firstborn." Now, this is instructions God was giving Moses even before Moses went to talk to him. So if he sent and relayed that message, evidently Pharaoh ignored it. and all these other plagues come upon him, and finally he lost his son.
Yes, sir. And we shouldn't take the idea of Pharaoh that Pharaoh never had a choice. The Bible does say that God hardened Pharaoh's heart, but Pharaoh hardened his heart in the first place. Mm-hmm. See, Brother Owen, Brother Owen said several things that I remember over the years. By the way, I think it is this week. We were not here for the first week that Brother Owen was here. We were at another church. We came the next week, but it's been 6 years today, I believe, that I've been doing the Sunday school class, and I want to thank Brother Owen and thank the church and all of your participation. I've enjoyed doing it, and so it's a pleasure to continue to be up here. But we don't need to. Brother Owen has said several times over the years that sometimes the worst judgment God can send upon you is giving you what you want. See, because Romans chapter 9 says that God creates vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. And people want to use that. There are certain people that want to use that to promote Calvinism. Well, if you go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, it says that you can choose whether or not you're going to be a vessel of honor or a vessel of dishonor. So you can decide which kind of vessel you're going to be. Pharaoh made his decision. If Pharaoh would have got in his chariot and rode down to Moses on about that third plague, I mean, those plagues are just unbelievable. But if Pharaoh would have gotten in his chariot and went down to Moses and said, "Hey, Moses, your God is God," you think those plagues would have stopped? In a heartbeat. See, that's what he did on the movie. At the end of the movie, he said, "His God is God." Well, that's not really what happened. What really happened is he ended up at the bottom of the Red Sea, along with the rest of his army. But had he chosen God's way, he would have been fine. So let's make sure that we understand what the scripture's saying. There is no one that's ever lived that existed outside of the boundaries of God's redemption. No one, not Pharaoh, not Judas Iscariot, not Ted Bundy or Adolf Hitler. Listen, light has been given to everyone. John 1:9 says that God lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Psalm 19 says the heavens declare his handiwork. So the rejection of light produces more darkness. Right. Not just darkness, more darkness. You're worse off than when you were before. Miss Kelly, bring the mic over here to Miss Kelly. Please, sir. And then Brother Donnell.
I'm enjoying reading and finding a lot of nuggets that I've heard before. So it's hard to find a brand new thing, but when it comes, it just jumps out at you. Anyhow, I think we're all familiar with how God promised Abraham, the man Abraham, that his seed would multiply.
Yes,
and raise
sir.
Generations.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. The question I'm going to ask, and then I'm going to answer it, was what woman did he promise? Her seed. Okay. And the answer is found in Genesis 16. And God said to Hagar, Sarah's maid, where are you coming from? And down in verse 10, the angel of the Lord said unto her, I will multiply thy seed exceedingly, that it shall not be numbered for the multitude. And that just, well, I didn't know he'd ever use those phrases for a woman, but he has.
Years ago, talking about stuff you never noticed before, years ago, Renita and I were at the radio station back when we owned another radio station, and I spent about 70 hours a week there at that time, and we were going through the Bible. Of course, we weren't dating, we weren't anything like that. We just were friends back then, sometime. But we were talking about the book of Genesis, and we noticed that there were two trees in the book of Genesis. There was the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and the tree of tree of everlasting life or something? Tree of life. And so I called up Brother Mac. I was excited to tell Brother Mac what I'd found. So I called up Brother Mac and told Brother Mac, and I went through this whole dissertation, and I was all excited. And Brother Mac, He said, I feel about an inch tall. I guess because he thought that he thought I should have gotten it by now. But anyway, it's odd because I knew there was a tree of knowledge of good and evil. And I mean, I was, when I found this, I was, I don't know, 25 years old, 22, 23. But there was also the tree of life. But it's just weird how things pop up. It's weird. Matter of fact, just the other day I was studying Revelation, and there's one part where there's a battle between, there's a battle in Revelation, but it's not the battle of Armageddon. It's not the battle of Armageddon. It's another battle. And I was putting those two battles together. So the Bible is a living book, which is why we read it every single year. Because if you'll submit to it, and if you'll push yourself, see, we all push ourselves, but if you'll push yourself for that reason, if you'll push yourself to do that and ask the Lord to show you something, then I can just about guarantee you that He will. Because if you read the Bible and you don't get anything out of it, it's not God's fault. All right, Brother Donnell.
I think I've made reference to it before, but when you spoke a few minutes ago about sometimes the worst judgment God can give you is to give you your own way, give you what you ask for, that sort of thing. That principle is confirmed in Psalm 106:15, which says, "And He," referring to the Lord, "gave them their request, but sent leanness into their soul."
He gave them their request and sent leanness to their souls. See, God doesn't violate a man's free will. But at the same time, God is never out of control. Nope. You say, explain that. I can't. I just know it's right. I know it works. I know that God never violates a man's free will, and God never sacrifices His control in the overall scheme of things. He's always in charge. One thing that my wife pointed out to me, she's a little bit ahead of me right now, And one thing that she pointed out to me was, whenever Joseph's daddy died, and his brothers went to him and said, "Now, Daddy told us you had to, Daddy said you had to forgive us. That he said you had to forgive us." Well, there's no record of him ever saying that. They're still conniving. Now, I don't mean to sound critical. I would have been too. This was the second most powerful man in the most powerful nation in the world at that time. But here's my point. Wasn't it obvious through Joseph's actions up to that point that he had already forgiven him?
Yep.
I mean, maybe the reason why his father never actually said that is because his daddy already knew. His daddy already knew what kind of man Joseph was. His daddy already knew that Joseph had forgiven him. You say, Brother Paul, what's your point? Imagine how the Lord feels when people come to the Lord and say, "Lord, forgive me of my sins." He's already forgiven us of our sins. He already has. Now, I understand believers do that. I understand believers that confess sins. Believers confess sins, which is not the same as asking forgiveness, by the way. But see, but the Bible actually says that Joseph wept. The Bible says that when his brothers did that, it grieved him. Perhaps he was thinking to himself, "Don't you know by now that I've forgiven you? Don't you know by now there's nothing between us? Don't you know by now how much I love you?" See, the point is, today, mainly in the, I mean, it's going on right now, but mainly in the 11 o'clock hour, a large portion of the world, because a large portion of missionaries all over the world outside this country, a large portion of the world, although not as large of a portion as it used to be, but a large portion of the world is having some type of services right now. And they're going to have another service in the 11 o'clock hour. And you know what they're going to tell people? They're going to tell people what to do to get God to forgive them. That's what they're going to tell people. They're going to get up and they're going to give you a process. Or either, maybe they won't do that. Maybe they'll get up and preach about how Jesus died for the sins of the world, and how God in the flesh came down to the earth and died for their sins. And then when the person gets to the altar, the person at the altar will tell them, here's what you have to do to get God to forgive you. In other words, Christ died so that for you to come and get the rest of it fixed with your prayer. See, what you have to do is come up to the altar. Here's what you have to do. You have to come up to the altar and you have to pray a prayer. And you have to promise some version of this prayer. You have to promise to never sin again. That's what you have to do. You have to confess all your sins and promise to never sin again. Well, let me ask you a question. How are you going to do that?
Yeah.
How are you going to promise to never sin again? Well, and if you do slip up and sin, you got to confess them every night before you go to bed. What about the ones you don't remember? Well, God gives us grace for that. He's already given us grace for all of it.
Amen.
See, Hebrews 1:3 says, when he had purged our sins, past tense, he's already purged our sins by himself. By him. Somebody said, I was in Todd Patrick's office. My brother's a night owl, which means that the week he was in town, I was a night owl. And he came to the office. He sat down, and you know, we were talking about sports and movies and all the stuff we talk about. And then he said, all right, I want to talk about something that matters. I said, all right. He said, let's talk about the Bible for a minute. I'm glad he realizes that it's okay to talk about movies. Movies are fun to watch. You ought to be careful what you watch, but movies are fun to watch. Football is fun to watch. I love football. I'm going to watch some football tomorrow night. Football is fun to watch. But that, none of that stuff matters. It doesn't matter in the whole scheme of things. He said if a person believes that Jesus is God and Jesus died for their sins, he said, tell me what's wrong with the sinner's prayer. That wasn't his exact question. But he said, tell me what's wrong with it. I said, all right, let's go through it. So I got my Bible out. And I said, when you discuss the sinner's prayer, you have to discuss the whole package. It comes in a package. You got to take it all. I said that the sinner's prayer is some version of. Now certain churches will actually push it to the point, and I'm sure Brother Barker knows this. He travels all over the country. But certain churches will actually push it to the point where they actually tell you what to say. They actually tell you exactly what to say. Other churches won't really do that necessarily, but there's some version of this. Within the sinner's prayer, there is some version of asking Jesus to forgive you of your sins. There's some version of, and most people, and the additional problem is that most people who believe in the sinner's prayer also believe that a person who's saved, if a person were really saved, they wouldn't do certain things. Like if a man leaves his wife, which he clearly should not do, clearly, there's no way to justify that. Well, but if a man leaves his wife, then someone will say, well, if he were really saved, he wouldn't have done that. And see which kind of pushes works. And they also believe, because I've talked to them, they also believe that most of them also believe that Judas Iscariot is some kind of a special case. So they believe by extension that redemption is not necessarily available to everyone. And they also believe, and I'm going through this with them. I said, and I'm giving y'all a short version. This is a 3-hour conversation. And I said, and they also believe that there are things you can do or not do that puts you outside of redemption. You can't be saved. I said, now, but aside from all that, some version of, within that prayer, there is some version of, ask Christ to forgive you of your sins. I said, so they clearly don't understand when sin was taken care of. I said, for that to be an issue, I said, the person at the altar dealing with the individual, they don't understand it. And the person that's being dealt with clearly don't understand it. I said, and I said, here's the problem with that. If you don't know when sin was forgiven, then there's a gap. There's a gap between you and God. God's over here, and you're over here trying to figure out a way to get to Him. I said, now, they have to give you a mechanism to get across that gap. Because their theology, not the theology of the Bible now, not the theology of the Bible, their theology has now created a gap. You're up here because you need a mechanism. You clearly don't understand when sin was forgiven. And based on Scripture, you must understand when sin was forgiven, because you had no part in it. A transaction occurred between God and Christ. Not between God and man. Between God and Christ. God said, I demand perfection. I demand absolute 100% perfection 100% of the time. We can't do that. Now, some of us are closer than others by man's standards. Brother Barker is much closer to perfection than I am. I have no doubt of that. But compared to God's glory, compared to the righteous, perfect, eternal glory of God, both Brother Barker and I are short. You say, how do you know that? Because that's what the Bible says. My brother would make a statement. I said, yeah, but that's not what the Bible says. This is what the Bible says. Which means you need to know what the Bible says, which means if you're going to deal with people, you need to read and study the Bible, which again is why we have a 60-day Bible reading revival to start the year off. Now, that shouldn't be the only time of the year that you read the Bible. Clearly, that should not be the only time of the year that you read the Bible. But it's a structure time to where the body comes together to edify one another, and you ought to get involved in it. So now you got a mechanism issue. You've got to tell that person what they have to do to get forgiven of their sin. So now you're in an area. Here's what happens when you do that. You are now ventured into an area that the Bible does not support. Now you're out kind of out in no man's land. You're floating over here without a foundation, because the Bible says that sin has already been forgiven. The Bible says that we have already been redeemed. The Bible says we've already been reconciled. You say, how do you know that? Well, we probably should look at some verses. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm looking at the time here. Obviously, I'm not going to get to Matthew 15 today. We'll get to that another day. Now, I'm not playing on my phone. I got a Bible on my phone, and this is not really good because I don't let my students do this. I tell them they need to be turning pages in the Bible. So you'll forgive me. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 19. Well, let's look at verse 18. and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Now, I happen to have a degree in English, but don't let that impress you. The only reason I got it was to get away from math. That's the only reason. Now, I do know a little bit. I mean, I'm joking around. I do know a little bit about it. But I'm no brother. I'm no Rob Donnell. When I have an English question, I call him. But that's past tense. Who hath reconciled us to himself by prayer.
No.
Is that what it says? By Jesus Christ. Now, 18 tells us what he did. 19 tells us how he did it. To wit, that's old English. That's how they talked when Brother Joe was a little boy. Joe Jones was a little boy. That's how they talked. To wit, that means to witness. To wit that God... My phone just turned off and I got it memorized, but I don't want to misquote it. To wit that God was in Christ, which simply means that Christ was in God and God was in Christ. Jesus was God in the flesh. You're going to need to know that, by the way. To wit that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. To wit that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. Not imputing. Notice this now. Not imputing their trespasses unto them. So this would mean, and by the way, this is applied to the world, not just believers. Clearly. Give me 1 second, and if I forget, keep waving at me. But this is applied to not imputing their trespasses. So my sins, my sins were never imputed to me insofar as the penalty is concerned. Now sin costs you something. If you go out and practice sin, it costs you something in this life. And it costs you something as a believer insofar as rewards are concerned. No, what we are talking about now is the eternal penalty of sin. Sin still has an effect. If I go out and commit sin, it's going to have an effect on my marriage. It's going to have an effect on my influence, on my testimony. If I go out and commit sin enough times and it becomes public, I'll no longer be the Sunday school teacher here. That's not what we're talking about. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. That's talking about eternal separation from God.
Yep.
That's what that's talking about. The wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23, Hebrews 2:9. Jesus Christ tasted death for every man. Not just for those who he knew would get saved. Not for everybody except Judas Iscariot. It's not what it says. He tasted death for every man. To wit that God was in Christ, reconciling the world. The word reconcile. A lot of times when someone gets divorced, what they put on the papers is irreconcilable differences. That means we have a problem that we can't get over, we can't get under, and we can't get around. By the way, you can. You can get over it, you can get under it, and you can get around it. If you're looking for a way, but it's not a message on marriage, and I've only been married, next week will be a week and a half, will be 9 years, so I'm no authority. But to reconcile means to remove the issue. To remove the issue and bring the parties back together. Now, who are the two parties? Two parties are God and man. Isaiah 53 says we've all gone our own way. We've all sinned to come short of the glory of God, Romans chapter 3. There's none good, no, not one. If you read Romans 3:10 through 20, it'll give you the indictment for all mankind. But man did not come together with God to fix the problem. That's not what happened. Christ came together with God to fix the problem.
Amen.
To wit that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. How did he do it? Not imputing their trespasses unto them. How do we know that? Because he imputed them to Christ. We've looked at the word reconcile. On occasion, my wife and I will have an argument. Just on occasion. Just on occasion, Brother JC. And the issue has to be reconciled. It's got to be dealt with. There's got to be a discussion. We got to talk about it. To reconcile means to remove the issue and bring the two parties together. So sin came between God and man. But man did not come together with God in order to remove that sin. Here's what happened. God came to earth as a man to die for the sins of the world. Now, he's only came and died one time. So logically speaking, that would mean that all sin would have to be dealt with at that time. That's what it would mean. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing. The word impute means to lay to your account. Whenever my son was wanting, they're wanting to go to Legoland. And they're supposed to be making the bed the other day, but they were jumping up and down on the bed. And we were talking. Johnny said, Daddy, we need to go to Legoland. I said, we can't go to Legoland right now. We don't have any money. I said, we just bought a new house and we don't have any money. He said, Dad, here's what he did now. This is 2017 kids for you. Here's what he did. He said, Daddy, you just take the credit card and you go, shoop. That's what he did. He did the motion of swiping a credit card. And he said, you did. I said, well, the problem with that, Johnny, is whenever you swipe that credit card, you're going to get a bill in a few months, and those charges are going to be imputed to your account. And they never miss one, Brother Stone. Now, Brother Stone knows. Me and Brother Stone goes back about 30 years. Brother Stone knows I learned this the hard way. But they never miss one. Those charges are imputed in your account, and if you don't pay them off, you got to pay what's called interest. But see, my charges were not imputed to my account. My charges were imputed to Christ. Why don't we just tell people that? Rather than telling people what they have to do to get God to forgive them, why don't we tell them that they've already been forgiven in the person and sacrifice and blood of Christ? Now, does that mean everybody's going to heaven?
Nope.
No, it does not. Look at verse 21 of chapter 5. We're going to read verse 9 again. Verse 19, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us. That's what Brother Rowan's going to do, or Brother Barker's going to do at 11 o'clock. Talk about reconciliation. The ministry, tell people they've already been reconciled. If you don't tell people what's already been done, then you have a message. Here's the danger. You have a message that is not supported with Scripture. When you tell people to pray a prayer, when you tell people, yeah, forgiveness is available, but you got to pull some kind of a trigger to get forgiveness, then you have a message that is not supported with Scripture. You're causing people to build their spiritual houses upon sand. That's what's happening. Yes, sir.
Tell you about that stuff right there. If it were possible, you'd fall away once you've accepted him.
Yes, sir. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he, God, hath made him Christ to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now go to Romans chapter 4. I got to hurry. Romans chapter 4. You say, does that mean everybody's going to heaven? No, it does not. Romans chapter 4, we'll look down at verse 21. And being fully persuaded, talking about Abraham, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised he was able to perform, and therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. In other words, when he was fully persuaded, when he understood who God was and what God did, when he placed his faith totally and completely in the finished work of Christ. Look at this. Verse 23. Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. Verse what? Verse 5, okay. But to him, it is a good one. But to him that worketh not. See, when you give somebody something to do, it's a work. Here's what Christ did, but here's what you have to do to get it. Pray this prayer. Now, I'm not saying if you prayed when you got saved, you didn't get saved. People say I say that, but I've never said that. I'm saying if you're relying on a prayer. See, when you tell people to pray a prayer, you know what their testimony is going to be? I prayed the prayer. And here's what's worse. Usually, they get kids to do it. So now, you don't just have a mechanism problem. Now what you have is an understanding issue. If you get my boys in here and ask them if Jesus is God, they're going to tell you, yeah. You know why they're going to tell you that? Because that's what I taught them. Does that mean they understand it? No, it does not. Right. See, we know from Samuel chapter 3, I'm out of time. We know from Samuel chapter 3, we know Samuel knew who God was because he was raised in a prophet school. But Samuel chapter 3 verse 1 says he knew not the Lord. Now what does that mean? It means that he did not have sufficient understanding at that time. So, but what people are going to do, I'm talking about hundreds of millions of kids today possibly. A child is going to find out that they're a sinner. And they don't want to go to hell because nobody does. And they're going to come forward and they're going to say, I don't want to go to hell. And you know what an altar worker is going to do? Well, do you believe Jesus is God? Yes, I do. Do you believe Jesus died for your sins? Yes, I do. Well, come on, let's pray this prayer. It may not happen exactly like that, but there's going to be some version of that all over this world today. And billions of people are going to hear what they have to do to get God to forgive them instead of hearing over and over and over again, instead of cultivating understanding and hearing over and over again that Christ died for their sins 2,000 years ago, that Christ and God met on Calvary. God said, I demand perfection. Christ said, I'll give you perfection. And God said, I'll take it. So because you're perfect, you're going to die for the sins of the world. And this is the only sacrifice that I'll accept. And we keep telling people what's already been done, showing them Bible verses, showing them Scripture, leading them in the Word of God until the Holy Spirit uses the Word of God to enlighten the mind of the individual to show them what's already been done and that Christ is sufficient until they take it by faith. Now, very quickly, brother Ron Mayhew, take the microphone, sir, and quote Ephesians 1:13. Or quote it or read it or something. I know some of you I told you I'd get and I didn't get. I'm very sorry. Go ahead, brother.
Ephesians 1:13, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise.
See, there's a process. You don't come to the knowledge of the gospel until you have some understanding. till you have some understanding. And it would be a shame to have that verse memorized but not understand its meaning. It'd be a shame. So let's tell people what Christ has already done for them. I'm going to ask Brother Rob Donnell, sir, to stand and close us in prayer.
Father, thank you for a clear explanation.